I'm Dr. Prabha, Senior Resident in Neonatology and as well as in Child Developmental Unit in Srihar. I am today taking a topic on routine care in NRP program. The steps involved in the routine care includes all the 5 steps, starting from providing warmth to the baby, and this is drying the baby from head to foot, and then wiping out all the secretions from the mouth if at all is there, and then followed by the mouth, nose also should be wiped clean, and the cutting the cord in 1 to 3 minutes, then keep the baby with the mother. Skin to skin care has to be established after the cord is clamped to effectively continue the warmth, and the initiate breastfeeding by placing the baby prone between the mother's breast. So these all 5 steps are very essential to be done soon after the baby is delivered and given to the neonatologist. By the time assess the baby's breathing, color, activity, and the tone of the baby during the interval of cord clamping. The delayed cord clamp, as I have mentioned, it is the time interval of clamping and cutting the cord as soon as the baby is delivered, for a period of 1 to 2 minutes. So the preterm newborns have the benefit of decreased mortality. There is a high blood volume pushed into the circulation from the placenta to the umbilical vein. There is less need for blood transfusion as a result of delayed cord clamp, and there is a lower risk of necrotizing enterocolitis. Then in a term newborn, there is a decreased chance of iron deficiency anemia, and furthermore, there is improved neurodevelopmental outcome in the subsequent periods. And what are the adverse effects? It delays the resuscitation for compromised newborns, and there is increased risk of polycythemia, where there is more blood pushed into the circulation, and hence there are RBC volume increases, and then resulting in jaundice as well. This is a labor room scenario wherein the baby is received soon after the baby is born. After a minute of time, the cord is clamped and the baby is put over the mother's abdomen for a quite period of time, wherein the skin to skin contact is established and the baby is put prone over the mother's abdomen, wherein even the breastfeeding can be initiated as soon as the baby is delivered. And here, the vitals also can be monitored simultaneously as a breathing pattern, change of any color, a heart rate, as well as the temperature. And the next is the observational care, wherein it is indicated when the baby is breathing well and the heart rate is more than 100 and required positive pressure ventilation for less than a minute. So these babies will be going for observational care, wherein the following steps are generally done. Here we are providing warmth to the baby as the first the drying of we are first drying this baby from head to foot, then followed by that changing the next towel and wiping clean and observing the breathing and temperature, as well as initiating the breastfeeding. Watching for complications, if any, like convulsions, lethargy, poor feeding, and respiratory distress. I monitor the vitals like breathing, heart rate, color of the baby, and the temperature check every 30 minutes for 2 hours in the observational ward. Here the baby is going to be kept along with the mother, the same in the rooming in as well. Thank you.
Hello everyone, I am Dr. Shafi from Sri Ramachandra Medical Center, Chennai. Today I will be speaking to you on the initial steps in resuscitation. So to start with, the objectives of this lesson are, in this we will be able to decide if a baby needs resuscitation or not, and we will also will be knowing how to open the airway and provide initial steps during the resuscitation process, and also how to provide pre-flow oxygen when needed. So, evaluation of newborn at birth. So, So in brief, after birth, we have to ask the following questions. I am sure in the previous lecture, you should have known how to counsel parents and what preparation you should do before going for delivery. Now, at birth, we have to ask these standard questions. Term gestation, whether baby has good tone, breathing or crying. If the answer for all these questions is yes, then the infant stays with the mother for routine care. This is called routine care. So you have already known about the routine care, where we provide warmth and push in the airway in such a way that baby have no difficulty in breathing, and clear the secretions if needed only, not regular suctioning. Drying, of course, for all babies need drying, and ongoing evaluation as told to you. Now, we are going to go to the next step, where one of these questions where is no. So if the breathing is not there, or baby not crying, no good tone, then the baby needs further steps in resuscitation. In routine care, we will wait for the delayed cord clamp, whereas here we should not wait for delayed cord clamp, as baby needs further care or further support for breathing. That's why we have to immediately cut the cord, and we have to take the baby to the warmer after briefly explaining the mother about the need for providing some amount of support during the resuscitation. So these initial steps include providing warmth to the baby under the warmer. There is a mnemonic called PSSR. It is for easy understanding and also for remembering. PSSR. P means positioning the baby in sniffing position. S for suctioning and clearing the airway. S for stimulating the baby by drying and removing the wet linen. R for repositioning the baby, as the position might have been altered due to the stimulation. Providing warmth. Babies born preterm are more likely to have difficulty with transition and should be evaluated carefully under a radiant warmer while the initial steps are performed. Placing the baby under warmer is important to provide warmth, and this warmer should be preheated. We should not put the blankets or towels which are being used by placing them on the top of the warmer, because it is not only risky of fire but also has contamination with the infectious particles or organisms, as the topmost part of the warmers are not being regularly cared for. We have to put the baby's newborn's head at the foot of the warmer so as to assess the baby for the airway. We should not block the radiant heat from the heater with the team members' heads or bodies coming under the radiant warmer area, so that baby will not get heat. Similarly, very preterm newborns may require placement in food grade plastic reclosable bag below the neck without drying to prevent heat loss. So for preventing heat loss, we should be keeping these babies as early as possible into this plastic reclosable bag. One word about vigorous or not vigorous. This actually you should all know what is vigorous means. As I mentioned here, vigorous is defined as a newborn who has strong respiratory efforts, good muscle tone, and a heart rate greater than 100 beats per minute. So these are vigorous babies. These babies do not need any initial steps. They directly go for routine care. So coming to initial steps proper, positioning. As I mentioned, in PSSR, P for positioning, for opening of the airways, it is to ensure of the ABCs, that is establishment of an open airway. The correct positioning of the newborn will bring the posterior pharynx, larynx and trachea in line, which will facilitate unrestricted air entry to the lungs. So this is only done by having the baby in sniffing position. This is how you get the sniffing position, is by positioning on the back or side or slightly extending the neck This is facilitated by placing a small shoulder roll under the back of the shoulder. This is depicted in this pictorial diagram here. You see here the patient airway with no obstruction to the airflow as the baby is having slight neck extension with a shoulder roll here. So sniffing portion aligns posterior pharynx, larynx and trachea. If you are going to go to this place when you are extending the baby's head too much, which causes again there will be obstruction to the airflow due to the hyper extended neck. Similarly, if the neck is flexed too much, again there is obstruction to the airflow. Hyperextension or flexion of the neck may decrease air entry into the lungs. To help maintain correct position, you may have to place a rolled blanket or a small towel under the shoulders, as I mentioned earlier. So, coming to suctioning to clear the airway, always we have to suction mouth first before the nose. This is M before N if you take an alphabetical order in ABCD. So, M comes before N. So, mouth is suctioned before the nose to ensure that there is nothing for the newborn to aspirate if he or she gasps when the nose is suctioned. So, if the newborn has copious secretions, we have to turn the head to the side so that secretions will collect in the cheek and can be easily removed. Just you want you to play the video when the baby is being hesitated. They will be doing suctioning the mouth and nose. A term baby. So, initial steps, stimulation. So, once the baby is positioned properly, first suctioning is done, then we need to position the baby properly. So, positioning the newborn and suctioning secretions will provide enough stimulation to the baby to breathe. Drying also will provide stimulation for the baby. So, I will again show you the image video of the baby being stimulated. So, we have to stimulate by drying the baby all over the body. Especially drying is very good stimulus. Not only drying, actually if you dry head and folds, axilla, groin, neck, you can remove most of the secretions and this itself will stimulate the baby to cry. Yeah, coming to next. If the baby did not cry after you were drying, routine drying, you can continue stimulation when the baby did not respond to your routine stimulation while drying. So, the safe and appropriate methods of providing additional tactile stimulation are slapping or pricking the soles of the feet, gently rubbing the back, trunk or extremities. So, I can show you again the video here. So, you can see baby is limp, blue, not very active. So, they are cleaning, slapping the soles and stimulating the baby by. So, potentially hazardous forms of stimulation are slapping the back, buttocks, squeezing the ribcage, forcing the thighs onto the abdomen, dilating anal sphincter, hot or cold compresses or baths for the baby, shaking the baby vigorously. So, I am sure you would have known about primary apnea. So, if the baby is in primary apnea, any gentle stimulation will initiate breathing. But if the baby is in secondary apnea, no amount of stimulation will work for the baby. So, we should not waste time there. So, for again, coming to the third again, PSSR, the last part, SR, E position. So, we have finished PSSR, positioning, suctioning, stimulating and coming to D position. So, repositioning is needed for the baby as the baby position would have been changed as the baby is being stimulated. Baby has to be kept again in the initial position in the warmer with the shoulder roll under the shoulder to keep baby in sleeping position. Once initial steps are done, the baby has to be evaluated for respiration, heart rate and color. Now, while how to evaluate? So, decisions and actions during resuscitation are based on evaluation of respiration, heart rate and color. So, once you finish initial respiration, one has to decide what to do next. Depends on your evaluation of these three parameters. Respirations, baby should have good chest movement with adequate rate and depth of respiration. And gasping is ineffective aspect of respiration. And heart rate, baby should have minimum heart rate of more than 100 beats per minute. Count beats for 6 seconds and multiplied by 10. For example, in 6 seconds, the heartbeat is 8 times. Then you have to just multiply it by 10 by adding 0 to the 8, it becomes 80 beats per minute. So, and announce the actual heart rate to the person who is waiting for your heart rate. So now, looking for color, pink lips and pink trunk is ideal. Subtle cyanosis indicates hypoxia. So we have to always use stethoscope to check for the heart rate. Again, subtle cyanosis and acrocyanosis, there are two different things. Subtle cyanosis is caused by too little oxygen in the blood and causes a blue hue to the lips, tongue and central trunk. Acrocyanosis is a blue hue to the hands and feet only, tips only. Only subtle cyanosis needs intervention. Acrocyanosis by proper warming itself, it will correct on its own. Free flow oxygen coming to. So when the baby looks cyanotic, blowing oxygen over the newborn's nose so that the newborn breathes oxygen with enriched air. That's why we have to give free flow oxygen. So free flow oxygen is indicated for subtle cyanosis. Free flow oxygen cannot be given by a mask attached to self-inflating bag. So here, free flow oxygen can be given using one of the following methods. They are flow inflating bag and mask, oxygen tubing and oxygen mask. So I'll be showing you the videos how it is played. So while baby being given oxygen by mask, baby's face mask should be kept as close as possible to the mouth of the baby and nose of the baby, so the air enters the baby's respiratory tract. It should be away. So it is actually very closely kept oxygen through oxygen tube. By holding the oxygen tube from in the hand and closing the nose along with the tube as near as much as possible to the free flow oxygen by flow inflating bag, flow inflating bag and mask. So the flow inflating bag is here, the mask is also kept very close to the mouth and nose. Now coming to free flow oxygen. Blowing the oxygen over the newborn's nose so that the newborn's breaths are enriched with oxygen. As we mentioned earlier, free flow oxygen cannot be given reliably by a mask attached to a self-inflating bag. Flow inflating bag should be used, not self-inflating bag. And wall or portable oxygen sources send at least 100% oxygen through the tubing. So we can directly give this tube flow towards the nose. Whenever you say oxygen flow, usually at least 5 liters per minute out of the tubing or mask should be provided. When it mixes with room air, which contains 21%, the amount of oxygen will be less than 100%. It is important to have the oxygen mask or tube very close to the newborn's nose to provide the highest possible concentration, as I mentioned earlier. So, delivering free flow oxygen, it is not good for the baby. So, if you are going to give for longer than few minutes, then it has to be heated and humidified to prevent heat loss and drying of the respiratory mucosa. Flow rate should be approximately 5 liters per minute, and high flow rates of oxygen greater than 10 liters per minute can cause convective heat loss and chill to the newborn because of rapid flow. The oxygen should be gradually withdrawn until the newborn remains pink while breathing in room air. So when the baby becomes pink, the oxygen should be gradually withdrawn depending on the pink color of the baby or saturation monitoring, whichever is feasible. Newborns who became cyanotic as oxygen is withdrawn should continue to receive enough oxygen to remain pink during this period. So when evaluating if the baby has persistent cyanosis, apnea or heart rate less than 100, then what you supposed to do? So continued use of tactile stimulation in apneic newborn wastes valuable time. We should not do that. For persistent apnea, begin positive pressure ventilation immediately. The entire process till now should have taken not more than 30 seconds. So when you evaluate this respiration, heart rate and color, the baby's apneic or heart rate less than 100, you directly go for PPV, don't wait and waste time. Whereas if the baby is breathing and the heart rate is above 100 but only cyanotic, you have to give supplemental oxygen initially, but if it persistent to be cyanotic in spite of your 100% oxygen, by which you are delivering either by tube or by mask or by flow inflating bag, you have to again start your PPV. Thank you. Good morning all. Today I am going to speak to you about positive pressure ventilation in newborn during resuscitation. The objectives of this topic are to know when to give PPV and the types of resuscitation devices what we have, how to operate each device, and to know how to correctly place the face mask on the baby, troubleshooting of the resuscitation devices, and also evaluating the success of PPV. So, before going to the topic proper, I would like you to know what are the indications for PPV during resuscitation. So, the indications are apnea or gasping. If the baby has no breathing or baby has gasping breathing, you have to give PPV for the babies. Similarly, the heart rate less than 100 beats per minute, even if breathing is there, is also an indication for PPV. Occasionally, if the baby is persistently cyanotic, despite of giving 100% free flow oxygen, also needs PPV to be started. So, for you to understand, ventilating the lungs is the single most important effective step in neonatal resuscitation. And the success of ventilation depends on the effectiveness of this procedure. How effectively you are doing this ventilation is the important one to make the baby better. Coming to types of positive ventilation devices available. So, we have self-inflating bag, flow inflating bag, and TP resuscitator. The bag inflates without a compressed gas. Self-inflating bag usually inflates without a self-compressed gas source after it is squeezed. That's why it is called as self-inflating. So, it remains inflated at all the times. That's why we have to be sure that baby is getting oxygen flow through the oxygen inlet if you need to give oxygen. And also, we have to be sure that the attachments are properly placed before going. That we will be discussing during the lecture. Let me to show you the self-inflating bag. The self-inflating bag, as you know, has got a reservoir here, bag itself, and also there is a pop-off valve which will be kept here. This is a manometer or an adjustment, or this one, the connection can be given here. Is a mask placement. This is how the self-inflating bag looks like. Okay, coming to flow inflating bag, it looks like a deflated balloon. It inflates only when the gas flows into the bag and the opening, and when the opening is sealed, as when the mask is placed tightly on the newborn's face. So without this seal, it will be looks deflated. It will not work. So you should be sure about this during the process of using this method. The flow inflating bag, where this gas is filled by the connector from outside inside gas, there will be tubing again to measure the pressure PAP delivered to the baby and the mask adjusted. So this is actually the other end of the tube should be closed so that it will work properly. Without closing this, the bag will not inflate. So we have to adjust the mouth of the outlet of the bag here. TP resuscitator, it works only when the gas flows into it. The gas is directed into the environment. I will be showing you the TP resuscitator in a few just minutes. The gas is directed to the environment or to the baby by occluding or releasing the opening on the T-shaped tube with your finger or the hub. So, I am not sure how many of you are aware about the TPs. Looks like here, inlet for the TP resuscitator is outlet for the baby, which goes to the baby, and here adjustment knobs are there. I will be discussing with them when we come to that. Here in the patient end, we have a valve to adjust the peep of the baby. So this has to be adjusted before the starting of resuscitation. This is maximum pressure relief valve, inspiratory pressure control valve. All this should be checked before we start your resuscitation of the TPs. The advantage of self-inflating bag. The self-inflating bag always refills after being squeezed. That's why it's called self-inflating. We already discussed about it. So it's always inflated. The pressure release valve, which is called as pop-off valve, makes over inflation less likely. That is, if anybody inadvertently gives more pressure, greater than 30 to 40 centimeters of water, it goes off, thereby releasing the pressure. So the more pressure will not be going to the baby, and there will be less risk for the baby to have pneumothorax. PIP, peak inflammatory pressure, is controlled by how hard the bag is squeezed. The disadvantage being, this self-heating bag will work without a gas source. So we have to be sure that the oxygen is connected. And this requires also tight face mask seal to inflate the lungs. This requires oxygen reservoir if you are going to provide higher concentration of oxygen. Otherwise, it sucks room air and you may not be able to give more saturation, more FiO2, unless you provide reservoir to the self-inflating bag. One more thing we have to remember here is, this self-inflating bag cannot give free flow oxygen through the mask. That's why it cannot be used for CPAP. So no PEEP, there is no PEEP because there is no valve here. But if in some foreign countries and few centers, they may use special valve at the mask side of the ambu bag, where we can adjust the PEEP also. But generally, it is not available in India. To achieve 90 to 100% oxygen administration, when the bag is squeezed, a reservoir is a must. So without the reservoir, you may not be able to give more oxygen saturation, oxygen concentration through the air, which is being delivered to the baby. Flow inflating bag advantages are, delivers 21 to 100% oxygen, depending on the source. Because you are mixing air and oxygen there, so if you are giving more flow, it will be giving more of FiO2 and more of oxygen, depending on your mixing. It's easy to assess the seal on the baby's face, because if the seal is not there, the flow inflating bag will not be inflating. So you will know that seal is not properly kept. There is no seal is there, there is no proper seal there. It can be used to give free flow oxygen to the mask. This can be used to give free flow oxygen, but not the self-inflating bag. The bag will not inflate unless there is a tight seal against the baby face. That's why it is easy for us to assess the quality of the seal. But the disadvantages are, it requires a compressed gas source, and it requires a source to inflate. If empty, it looks like a deflated balloon. It requires a tight face mask seal to remain inflated, as we discussed earlier. Usually it does not have a safety pop-off valve here. It will be mounted. Usually it's a flow control valve to regulate the pressure inflation. We can check the pressure, how much delivered, by the manometer. And the PEEP, actually, or CPAP, is controlled by adjustable flow control valve here. We need to have pressure manometer to use to avoid excessive inflation pressures to be delivered to the baby. So coming to TP resuscitator, this resuscitator provides a flow controlled and pressure limited ventilation, or CPAP. We can give many a times, this is used for transporting a baby from one place to other. For example, from labor room to NICU, if you don't have a ventilator, transporting ventilator. So this actually, this as a manually cycled mechanical ventilator, it works as a manually cycled mechanical ventilator. Advantages being, it consistently delivers the pressure, reliable control of peak inspiratory and positive PEEP. PEEP also can be delivered. We can reliably deliver oxygen, percentage of oxygen, 100% if you want to deliver. So there is no fatigue from bagging. If you are continuing to bag, you may get tired over time. But here, this TP is, you will be very, very comfortable to use. We will be showing it to you during the lecture, how it is used. So, but disadvantage being, again, it requires a compressed gas source. It must have a tight face mask seal to inflate the lung. The compliance of the lung cannot be felt here, because you are not bagging directly. You are just putting your finger up and down on the TPs. It requires the pressure to be set prior to use. So when you are going to use it, you need to adjust the PIP what you require and PEEP what you require in this machine. Changing pressures during the use is something difficult. It's not easy to control the pressure changes during the procedure. Coming to general characteristics of resuscitative devices, appropriate size mask should be available at every delivery, and anatomically shaped mask preferred, because the shape of the mask is like anatomical, it easily snugly fits the mouth and nose. And again, variable oxygen capability to deliver up to 90 to 100% should be available, at the restoration areas. Control of peak inspiratory pressure and inspiratory time should be done if necessary. When you use a bag, the bag size should be having at least the capacity of the bag should be around 200 to 750 ml. And the term babies requires usually 15-25 ml each ventilation. Maximum you may give 5 to 8 ml per kg. In all newborns, we will calculate the volume according to the weight. So if it is 5 to 8 ml per kg, so baby for example 3 kg baby 15 ml to 20 ml around. The small amount of volume we need. We don't need to have a bigger size mass, bigger size bags. To minimize complications for high ventilated pressures, device should be safely checked for avoiding high pressures being delivered to the babies, like pop-off valve and the self-inflating bag. And PAP in the, you have to check PAP, set PAP in the TPs and also in the pressure flow inflating bags. The safety features of distribution devices are a pressure gauze or a flow control valve, as you mentioned, pressure release valve are important. Sometimes emergency backup. You will have a self-inflating bag available as a backup whenever distribution may be needed in case of a compressed gas source fails because gas suddenly goes off from the cylinder or not available. When TP small functions, you should always have a backup for with the self-inflating bag which doesn't need any backup of power or even source of pressure. So here we are going to just show you that how to self-inflating bag pressure release valve works in the video. Here we are going to check the pressure over the pump. While you squeeze the bag, you feel the pressure over the pump, there is no leak. And to check the pop-off valve is working or not, you need to see whether the release valve, here to check actually pressure how much generated. You can see the pressure going up to 30 to 40. So you can keep monitoring the pressure while you close the pop-off valve and see. Coming to flow inflating bag. So a pressure manometer attached in the bag, as I mentioned, will allow proper adjustment of the valve. Again, to just check, just want you to consider. See here, this is a pressure flow inflating bag. Again, we can see the pressure generated. The valve is inflated, pressure is controlled here. And the bag is being inflated with the oxygen coming from outside, air source, without which it will not work. So this is about flow inflating bag. Which is TP resuscitator. There are two controls to adjust the inspiratory pressure. The first one is the inspiratory pressure control set the amount of pressure desired during the normal assisted breath. So inspiratory pressure, this is the inspiratory valve. This is the maximum inspiratory control valve. So we can set the maximum pressure how much ever you want to keep and then it will allow the baby to receive only that pressure. It cannot go beyond that pressure. Whereas the required inspiratory pressure is set by this valve. The maximum pressure release for control is a safety feature that prevents the pressure from exceeding a preset value of whatever set you have done for the baby. So this is the setting of TPs. So air flows here from the source. The maximum relief valve will be already adjusted before starting of resuscitation. And also you have set the PIP by inspiratory pressure setting here. Air goes out here and at the hand you are able to control your PEEP. That will be showing you as a video here. TPs. So we are adjusting the inspiratory pressure here. And see here when you are closing it, you can see that pressure raising here. So this is PAP. So what you set now is PAP. The inspiratory pressure will not be set more than 20 usually. And what we are adjusting now is PEEP. So by rotating the patient end of the TPs, you will be able to see the PEEP generated. So you can see the PEEP coming to oxygen concentration during positive ventilation. In term babies, NRP recommends use of 100% oxygen when PPV is required during resuscitation. If resuscitation started with less than 100% oxygen, oxygen should be administered if there is no appreciable improvement within 90 seconds following the birth. If oxygen is unavailable, then use room air to deliver positive pressure ventilation. So we should not be worried about only oxygen. Even without oxygen, you can start your resuscitation. Coming to free flow oxygen, this cannot be given reliably through the mask. It is self-inflating bag, as you mentioned earlier. Oxygen flow entering a self-inflating bag will normally be diverted to air inlet. It goes reversely and goes out of the air inlet or attached to the reservoir, which after attached, reservoir gets filled. So it can be delivered reliably through either mask of the flow-inflating bag or the TP resuscitator. One thing you have to remember is self-inflating bag will not be able to give free flow oxygen. Coming to bag and mask, they have got different types. There are different rims. We have got cushioned rims, non-cushioned rims. Cushioned rims advantages are it conforms clearly and fits clearly with the shape of the face, making it easier to form a seal. Requires less pressure to obtain a seal, and there is less chance of damaging the eye. The mask is incorrectly positioned. Non-cushioned, more difficult to obtain a seal because it does not easily conform to the shape of the face. It can damage the eyes if the mask is improperly positioned. Non-cushioned, so it can breach the baby's face if the mask is applied too firmly. So non-cushioned mask has got a danger of this all damaging eyes and also breaching the face if you are not properly using it. Coming to shapes, we got round masks and also anatomically shaped masks. Anatomically shaped mask fits with the contours of the face when placed on the face of the baby, and the pointed part fitting should be over the mouth, nose of the baby. Size depends again, depending on the term or preterm, we have different size of mask. For term baby, we will take number 1 size. For preterm baby, we will take 0 size mask. Here, mask should cover the tip of the chin, mouth and nose. So, this is a round shaped mask, what we are seeing here. This is a anatomical shaped mask, covering the nose and mouth. But you should concentrate that this should not cover the only one mouth or only nose. So, it should be covering both mouth and nose, including with the tip of over the tip of the chin. Preparation of resuscitation device. So, if a self-pivoting bag is used, we should be sure that reservoir is attached. If a T-piece resistor is used, the set pressure settings according to the recommendation should be adjusted before you start your resuscitation. So, you have to assemble the equipment before you start your resuscitation. So, the equipment should be also tested. So, especially checking for the self-inflating bag, how it works or not. So, we have to be sure that it's working. Because many times, in many places, bag and mask resuscitation is not being used regularly, because many babies do not need bag and mask ventilation unless they are apneic or the heart rate is less than 100. So, many times, many baby, 99, almost 95% around, do not require bag and mask. So, we need to be checking the baby self-inflating bags as they are not being regularly used. So, how to do this checking is actually blocking the mask of the patient outlet with the palm of your hand. We have to feel the pressure against your hand so that there will be proper seal. There is no tear or there is no leak happening. Pressure gas should be registering at least 30 to 40 millimeters of pressure when the pressure release valve is opens. If not, we have to check for a crack or leak in the bag. Check to see if the pressure gauge is missing, if the pressure release valve is missing or stuck or closed, the pressure valve is closed, not working. So, these things should be checked before you start your resuscitation. Otherwise, this bag will not work and the whole process of resuscitation will be a waste if you don't have a properly working bag. So, you should know how to check the mask. How to check the bag and mask? There is an ambu bag, self-inflating bag during resuscitation. You have to see for the seal and also for the pop-off valve working or not. These two are very important. Before beginning preparation of checklist PPV, we have to select an appropriate sized mask and we have to clear the airway and position the baby as we said in the initial steps of resuscitation and position the baby at your side so that you are standing at the baby's head. So, it is easy, comfortable for you to handle and give a bag and mask ventilation, not beside the baby. It is always better to stand at the head side of the baby. Positioning on the mask on the face. So, we should not jam the face mask down on the face. Do not allow the fingers or hands to rest on the eyes so that it will not cause bradycardia. Do not put pressure on the throat. We should not be pressing on the throat while doing bag and mask ventilation. So, to improve the face mask seal, we have to use light downward pressure, slightly pressure down, which may gently squeeze the mandible up and towards the mask. What we should do is, we have to keep over the two fingers over the base of the mask, we have to press down slightly. With the little bit, we have to lift the jaw up towards the mask so that there will not be any leak while you do that. So, airtight seal is essential to achieve effective pressure. This tight seal is required for flow inflating bag to inflate, otherwise the flow will not inflate the bag and the bag will not work. Tight seal is required to inflate the lungs when the self-inflating bag is filled. If you are using self-inflating bag, if tight seal is not there, they will not be having chest rise and will not have inflating lungs during the process of PPV. Tight seal also required to inflate lungs when the PEEP cap occluded PCM by TC, TP sustainer. So seal, without seal, any of these equipment will not work. That is the basic idea of telling all these points. So what are the signs of effective ventilation? We learnt about the equipment, types of equipment, what are the precautions that you take when you are going to start the PPV. And here we are going to learn, if you are starting PPV, so how much you are sure that you are giving adequate ventilation or not. So the first thing to happen is improvement in heart rate. Then later the color and the tone may increase. So the signs of improvement in newborn are improvement in heart rate, color, and baby may have starts to have spontaneous breathing, tone may improve, and saturations also will improve one by one. So if these signs are not improving, then we have to look for presence of chest movements with each PPV. Chest movements we have to be concentrating. So the breaths often require higher pressures or longer inflate. Sometimes initial period the lungs may need longer pressure, longer inflation time, and higher pressures to inflate. So ventilating lungs with the lowest pressure required to improve heart rate. So we have to ventilate the babies with the lowest possible pressure. That doesn't mean you need to always give higher pressure, but the lowest possible pressure to improve the lungs. Monitor pressure with the pressure gauge always to avoid high lung volumes and airway pressures. Because it is said that even slightest increase in pressure of even one breath will damage the lungs. So the ideal is you have to see the chest rise. It should be appropriate, like what we smoothly raising chest we should see. We should not see a rapid raising or a huge amount of chest rise happening during the procedure, which will cause unnecessary damage to lungs, sometimes even cause pneumothorax. Overinflation lungs. If the baby appears to be receiving very deep breaths, when you are giving too much of pressure is being delivered, there is always, as you mentioned, pneumothorax will be there, develop, and it may cause more damage to the baby than helping. The volume of newborn breath is much smaller than the amount of gas in the resuscitation bag. It usually said that 1/10 of a 240 ml bag, self-inflating bag, 1/10, 24 ml almost, is enough. And 1/30th of the 750 ml flow inflate bag. If you are using the 750 bag, you should be giving 1/30th of bag. So abdominal movement may be due to air entering the stomach and should not be mistaken for effective ventilation. So if you are going to auscultate the air, you should be very confident enough to tell that abdominal air is not entering the stomach. So because you have to always, when you check for air entry, you have to assess both apexes, thoracic, there is axillary areas both, and then abdomen, stomach, over the stomach, to look for any air entering the stomach. So coming to, you squeeze the bag. Whenever you are starting your ventilation, they should be having a specific procedure to breathe. So you have to tell, when you bag, you have to tell breathe. When you release, you have to 2-3. So inflation is lesser, exhalation is prolonged compared to inhalation. So you have to say breathe 2-3, breathe 2-3, breathe 2-3. Why we have to tell like this is, unless you tell that you may not be providing the baby with 40 to 60 breaths per minute. If you are not pronouncing or uttering these words, breathe 2-3, you may give either rapidly, breathe 2-3, breathe without telling. You can just inadvertently give fast breathing, or sometimes you may forget to give regular breathing. So to make it regular, so we always, when you start your PPP, you have to always remember to say breathe 2-3, breathe 2-3, breathe 2-3. Your primary idea is to take care of the PPV. You should not concentrate any other thing during the procedure of PPV. So coming to infants not improving and just not adequately expanding. So what happens is the seal is inadequate. Possible causes are seal inadequate, airways blocked, and not enough pressure to be delivered. So these are the three possible causes when you have not improvement in heart rate and the chest is not adequately expanding. So the first, always the most important, is seal. We are discussing about seal for many times now. Seal inadequate. If you don't have seal, proper seal, then there is always air leak will happen, and any of these equipment will not work properly. Sometimes airway may be blocked due to secretions, that you have to take care. And at the end, you may not be having or delivering enough pressure during the ambu bag ventilation. When you are not having proper positioning, there will be this manometer will not be working perfectly. So this is about one thing. So here we have discussed about causes and solutions for inadequate chest expansion, that is called MR-SOPA. You can easy way to remember. So as you mentioned, the condition inadequate seal may be a common reason. Second is blocked airway, and the third is not enough pressure. So the actions what we're supposed to do for each one of these are mentioned here. M means mask reapplication to the face and lifting the jaw forward. This will avoid many times leak. That's why I mentioned earlier, when you put mask, you have to be sure about pressing the base of the mask from above and also pulling the jaw forwards towards you. So this is a very important step. Many times this is the commonest and most usual mistake what we do during the situation. Blocked airways, to avoid blocked airways, when you are sure that your mask placement is proper, then you may have to do R for repositioning head, suction if secretions are present, and you may even slightly open the mouth and then again reapply mask properly and again start your bag and mask ventilation by telling breathe 2-3, breathe 2-3, breathe 2-3. So whenever you are doing, when a chest expansion is not happening, you have to look for each step's response every time. So start with mask reapplication and do proper bagging, breathe 2-3, breathe 2-3, breathe 2-3. So if response again not happening after 5 to 10 breaths, again you may have to do the second response. Again this is not happening after 5 to 10 breaths, then you need to increase your pressure. This is actually pressure at the end. If you see pressure to be increased until there is positive pressure point. This is actually that again, if you have a proper manometer, you can even check the pressure what you are delivering. Otherwise, you have to see that just is start to have movement at the end. And if all these measures you are not able to get the chest rise, then at the end we may have to go for A, which is alternate airway, which can be intubation or laryngeal mask airway. So this is about MR-SOPA. It's very important to remember. So I would like all of you to remember this MR-SOPA. So each one of you should know what to do when the chest expansion is not happening, when the heart rate is not improving. These are called as ventilatory corrective steps in the algorithm. So continued positive ventilation. So what you should do, if you are going to continue for a long time, then we may have to give orogastric tube insertion to relieve gastric distension, because some amount of air of course will go into stomach and it can cause the problem of the, it actually over distension of the stomach will cause ventilation inhibition, because the lung cannot ventilate, you cannot be having proper lung ventilation. So it always remember to insert OGT when you are going to have a continued prolonged PPV for a baby. So gas distension may cause elevated diaphragm and preventing full lung expansion and cause regurgitation and also aspiration. The best thing to do is you have to use the 8 size syringe, because bigger size syringe, bigger size feeding tube, so that the air will come out easily, not the smaller size. 6 or 5 will not be used here. Similarly, you should use a 20 ml syringe to withdraw air from the stomach during the procedure. So here we are going to tell you about how to insert and how much distance to be inserted. So measuring the correct length of the tube is from bridge of the nose to the ear lobe. From bridge of the nose to the ear lobe. And then what happens, from ear lobe to point halfway between the xiphoid process and the umbilicus. Umbilicus and xiphoid process here is a halfway between. So this is the appropriate length to be inserted into the baby. So insertion of baby, I think you are all sure about it. So insert tube through mouth rather than nose, because through ventilation the air enters maximally through the nose. Attach 20 ml syringe and aspirate gently. Remove syringe and leave the tube to open it to let the air go out if accidentally air enters the stomach. And tape the tube to the newborn's cheek so that it not come out during the process of resuscitation. When the newborn is not improving, then we have to check for oxygen, bag, seal and pressure. All these things you have to again check during the process of resuscitation. And you have to concentrate, as you mentioned earlier, whether the chest is moving adequately or not. If adequate oxygen is being administered, and we have, is there any, if using self-inflating bag, reservoir is there or not, we have to check. Because we mentioned earlier, if you don't attach reservoir in a self-inflating bag, you may not be able to give more percentage of oxygen for the baby. Similarly, if you are using a tank rather than wall oxygen, is there any oxygen in the tank, we should check before that, during the procedure. Actually, we should all check all those things before the start of your resuscitation itself. So, is gas flowing through the flow meter? We have to check the flow meter also. This is one we usually miss about this part, so I am just putting it in bold. So, flow meter is working or not, a gas flow is coming or not, we have to check. Then, at the end, if everything is fine, then we have to consider your endotracheal intubation. And at the end, we should not even forget to check this pneumothorax if possible. So, it can happen because when you are doing inadvertently pressure with the stress, you may deliver high pressures and it may cause pneumothorax without your knowledge. Unwantedly, you may develop this, you may have this baby having pneumothorax. So, this should be checked by checking the breath sounds or by applying pen torch to the baby. Yes. So, newborn is not improving. The heart rate is less than 60 despite 30 seconds of possible ventilation. You can see here, we have given 30 seconds of PPV. He started PPV when the baby did not improve in initial steps, when we did initial step initially. So, the babies who had heart rate less than 100 or babies were apneic, those babies went for this PPV. So, when we did PPV for 30 seconds, effective PPV, what we mentioned as effective PPV with proper chest rise and improvement in heart rate. Then, if you continue for 30 seconds, after 30 seconds, if you assess the baby for heart rate, if heart rate less than 100, less than 60, sorry, so less than 60, then what you should do, we have to go to next step. We should not waste time in continuing the same step if you have done appropriately PPV for 30 seconds with effective ventilation, what we mentioned. So, this is about the thing, endotracheal intubation here. During the procedure, some people may not be confident about intubation. Some people would like to intubate at this stage or later, maybe, if they are not confident. So, as I mentioned here, intubation may be considered at several steps. So, if you are confident, you better intubate here so that your chest compressions can be coordinated properly during the next step of chest compression and PPV being done regularly. So, coming to that, reception of resuscitation devices, we already discussed self-inflating bag, flow-inflating bag, TP resuscitators. So, review devices used in your hospital, whatever you are using, you keep on referring here. So, I would like to tell you about the basic parts of the self-inflating bag here in the video. Here, you see here, babies are having, this is the oxygen inlet, where we will put oxygen, oxygen reservoir here, there is an air inlet here that we enter, this is a self-inflating bag, pressure gauze here, and what we have here is the pop-off valve, you might be knowing it already, valve assembly, this you have to check, patient outlet, then we have a self-inflating bag, so controlling of oxygen, so how to do it? An oxygen reservoir must be attached to deliver high concentration of oxygen using the self-inflating bag, otherwise oxygen will leak out. Without reservoir and oxygen attached, the bag delivers only 40% oxygen, which can be insufficient for the resuscitation. So, if you are giving oxygen flow without reservoir, then the air, oxygen comes out and you may not be able to provide more than 40% of oxygen during the procedure. Of course, you will be monitoring the pressure because pressure will be anyway monitored with the equal pressure whenever you are giving. But the amount of oxygen will be coming out. It will not be going entirely to the baby. So, this is about one thing you have to remember to attach oxygen whenever you are going to give more oxygen than 40%. It will not be helpful without reservoir. Now, when you are going to give more oxygen, 90% with reservoir, so let us see how this is going to help the baby. See here, reservoir is there. So, it is not leaking outside oxygen. Most of the oxygen is going to go. So, unpredictable oxygen flow if the bag is not squeezed. So, you have to bag along with that air oxygen enters and we can provide more amount of oxygen, more than 40% in the reservoir. I think you should understand, you'll be understanding by this. So, we have to always remember when you are going to provide more oxygen. So, this is about self-inflating bag, types of oxygen reservoirs. Some of them have open ends like here, open-ended reservoir. Or something have, somebody will have valves to allow some amount of air entering to the reservoir. So, there are different types of self-inflating bags available. So, here again, testing before use of self-inflating bag. I was telling you how to check. So let us see. See here, we are breathing. Here we are getting the pressure over the palm we are feeling. Here we are going occluding the pop-off valves. You see that how much maximum pressure we can give, deliver, so that we are sure that pop-off valve is working according to your adjustment. It will not be provided. And again, the amount of squeeze is depends. You have to be controlledly giving the pressure, whatever you need for the baby. So self-pneumatic bag, amount of pressure delivered depends on the three factors. How hard the bag is squeezed, the amount of pressure delivered by a self-pneumatic bag is not dependent on the flow of oxygen. Unless you bag, the air is not going to enter the baby. So any leak between mask and newborn face also will hinder the passage of oxygen or air to the baby. So set point of pressure release valve. So you have to see that pressure, how much it is delivered to the baby. So all this will control the pressure in a baby getting self-pneumatic bag resuscitation. I think you have already seen about resuscitation bags here. So resuscitation bags, you already know that flow-inflating bag, flow comes from here and it inflates the bag. We can control the pressure here, and this is the face mask. The bag will not inflate if the mask is not properly sealed over the newborn's mouth. Again, we mentioned before, if there is a hole in the mask, if the flow control valve is open too far and the pressure gauge missing. So there is no, all ports should be closed. That we have to carefully see in this bag. So here we can see the inflating the bag. Here, the flow inflating bag is getting oxygen. Oxygen, we have to inflate the bag with compressed gas, either oxygen, air, or both. Once the gas enters, the bag will inflate, but it's not diluting here. So you just see the flow control valve, how it works. So you can see here, oxygen flowing, flow control valve, you can adjust the flow control valve and the manometer here working. So 100% oxygen can be delivered to the baby through flow inflating bag. So this is how you can deliver 100% oxygen to the baby through. Coming to appendix. So there are parts of resuscitator, TPC resuscitator. We have 6 parts. Oxygen inlet, we mentioned here. Patient outlet, we mentioned again here. Inspiratory pressure control valve. This is a place where we have pressure valve. PEEP, adjustment at the patient end. Circuit pressure gauge. Again, we have pressure circuit pressure gauge here. Maximum pressure relief valve. I mentioned again how much to set the upper limit here, all mentioned here. So as you see here, this is the inflating the air entry. So inlet, oxygen is going into the TPS resuscitator here, and what is happening, the outlet gas comes out from here to the patient end. It's called inspiratory pressure control, and we have gas supply line, and we have got PEEP cap where you adjust the PEEP for the baby. And actually we have here circuit pressure gauge. This is the maximum pressure relief control valve. So these are set before you start your resuscitation. So now TP is how troubleshooting. So if when you are using TPs, you should be able to know how the troubleshooting of the baby will take place. Because usually when you are using it, it will be kept closely. As I mentioned here, you have to put a tight seal, and then you have to close the PEEP valve here so that you will deliver PIP and release your finger so that the PEEP, whatever is set, will be delivered. So this finger, instead of bagging, you will be using the finger as a bag and mask. So it will be very easy. You will not get fatigued according to this baby. So let me just see here how it's working, TPs. So when you are putting, it will be increasing PAP, and when you release, the PP delivered. So again, you see here TPs, they are setting the TPs before flow. You start flow. Flow will come here. Once you flow only, this PAP can be set. So once you put PEEP and PAP, it will work like this. So this is how you set your PPV. So this is actually finishes the video, and thank you for your attention. Any doubts, we can discuss.